STI. So let's take a look. This is that same A6 microprocessor which came out a few weeks ago. So you can see these are all your P-type or maybe N-type transistors, and you have this STI that you formed, which is separating them from a N-type region, which is somewhere else, not on this picture. So once you have formed these two regions, which are you have decided I'm going to make my N-type transistors here and my P-type transistors here, the next thing to do is implant them such that they become P-type or N-type, right? So you do well implants, and these are typically the highest energy implants because you want to implant a large depth, and so you put a sacrificial oxide because you're going to implant with such a high energy, you don't want to damage your substrate. So there's a sacrificial oxide that you put, and then many times you use not one implant but multiple implants, and then you do this for your P-well. Then you do the reverse mask and you cover your P-well and you expose your N-well, and if it's N-well you implant with phosphorus or arsenic, right? And then you anneal them together, so you they are activated and you have your P-well and your N-well region defined, right? So the next step is your gate oxide growth. This is typically a your gate oxide is your most critical oxide, so utmost care is taken while you're growing this. So it's typically a thermally grown oxide, not a deposited oxide. So it's done in a RTP chamber where you can grow it in an oxygen plasma in an oxygen environment. Many times people nitride it because that helps, first of all, it helps in improving your dielectric constant, and it also improves the barrier property of this oxide. So it helps from boron from diffusing into your dielectric. Later in week 5, we'll actually discuss the high-k metal gate flow and how, so that comes in at this place as well. If you're doing a gate first process, then you deposit high-k over here. If you're doing a gate last process, you move on and then you deposit your polysilicon gate. So this is an amorphous polysilicon gate, a blanket deposition across your wafer. Again, you want to etch it, so you want to, before you etch it, you need to make a hard mask. So you, in this case, you can use again a nitride as a hard mask. Some people prefer to use just carbon as a hard mask because they can very easily ash it off. But you put a hard mask, you put a resist, and you pattern that resist into the gate lines you want to form. You transfer that pattern from your resist into your hard mask, and then you etch that pattern into your polysilicon, right? And this is typically the most critical etch that happens in the entire process flow because it's at the very finest feature. At the same time, you're etching a poly region and stopping on a dielectric. And whenever you're etching, it's very difficult to stop on dielectric, especially if it's like a 1 nanometer thin dielectric. So anyway, if you do this etch, you get it right, then you you have achieved an accomplishment which is worth taking a picture. And if you take a picture at this point of time, it looks something like this. So for a 65 nanometer process, it looked something like this. For a 45 nanometer, you can see the lines are in fact more rectangular, and you can see the corners even better.
When you're using SOI, the top silicon layer, is that like defect free?
The top silicon layer is defect free, yes. So typically people deposit, so there's a, okay, since you asked it, let me show you. So this is a process for making SOI. So you start with a wafer, then you implant it with hydrogen. It's called a smart cut process. And then you put it on top of a handle wafer, and then you can cleave where the hydrogen was implanted. So it's a, that's why it's called a smart cut, because where you implant it with hydrogen, you can cleave it off. and that top layer is defective because, you know, it was implanted and then it had all the defects. But then what you do is you polish it. So you polish off that defective layer and you thin it down to the required thickness, which is defect free. So typically you implant something like 200 nanometer thick, and then you just thin it down till the very 20, 50 nanometer, which is defect free. So a question I had here was, why did actually lines become better from 65 to 45? So the reason they became more rectangular was, over here you're actually printing these rectangles. When people move to 45, they actually, what they did was they used to print in two steps. You print straight lines. So they were actually patterned, all of them straight together. And then there was additional printing done, and you cut them where you need to cut them. So it's two masks instead of one to make the same feature. That's why they look more rectangular. So we have a lecture on Wednesday where the person who is responsible for doing this will come here and he'll come and speak to us. Next step you do after you have done your gate patterning is you need to form your source and drain junction, right? So you need implants. And you need more than one implant. There are three essential implants which are needed. One is called a halo implant. So if it's an NMOS, that means it's made on a P-type substrate. This halo implant is of the same type, so it's a P-plus implant. And then you do a source drain extension implant. So this one is of the opposite polarity. So it's an N-type implant, but it's low in doping. So it's an N-minus implant. So minus means low, plus means high, right? So minus, it's an N-minus implant. And then finally you have the source drain large region, which is an N-plus implant. So why do we need three implants, right? So why do we need this P plus and why do we need this N minus? So the reason for that is we want to minimize the short channel effects. So we have a junction here. This is a PN junction. This is P, this is N, right? So we want to minimize this junction depleting under the gate. So we want to minimize our depletion width going inside the gate, because that will essentially just eat up our gate length. And I'm borrowing some knowledge from 216 here. So your junction, for any PN junction, your depletion in either sides, it depends upon how much doping you have in either side. So if you have a PN junction, your depletion width inside the P region is inversely proportional to the doping in that region. So if you have higher doping, you'll have less depletion in that particular region, right? So it's WN is inversely proportional to the square root of doping in that region. So if you want to have less depletion width in that particular region, you need to have more doping here. So if you want to have less depletion inside your gate, you need to put a higher doping here. And that's why you have this P plus implant and you have this N minus implant, because you want to the source and drain region to deplete in this direction rather than deplete in this direction, right? So that's why you have this fancy implant scheme. And the way it is done is, now you need three implants. So you first implant that is typically done is the extension implant. So again, you open up the region where you have your PMOS transistors, and this is your source drain extension implant. It's a low energy implant. It used to be low dose, so it used to be called LDD, or lightly doped drain. But now it's not that low a dose, because if you go very low in dose, or if you go very low in doping, then you'll have a very high resistance as well. But this is the next implant step. So you have the source drain extension implant. Then you implant these pockets. So you implant these pockets, and these are your halo implants. And the way this implant is done is, you need to implant it at an angle, right? So you hold your wafer at an angle, and this is your ion beam coming in, and then you rotate your wafer. So you rotate it like all 360 degree, so it gets this implant at an angle. So that's how this halo implant is done. So people became so sick and tired of doing these implants that one of the reasons for moving to FinFETs was that, you know, it became so difficult to control these implants so precisely that you form these junctions. And as we'll discuss later, going to a 3D transistor or a FinFET transistor simplifies this soil drain extension or your soil drain implants quite a bit. So then you do the same thing on your end region. So you implant your N soil drain extension, and then you do your halo implant over here, and then what is done is now you have done your halo implants, you have also done your extension implants. Now you need to do these deeper implants, which are your source and drain, actual source and drain high doping implants. And you don't want to damage the region which you already implanted. So you know, with all this rotating wafer and using low energy, I implanted all these regions. Now I want to protect them, right? So what I do is I make a spacer. And the way we make a spacer is the same way we make a spacer in lithography. That is, you deposit, you already have a featured surface. So you have this poly gate which are printed, so they're forming this feature, and you deposit this nitride layer conformally on your feature. And then what you do is you etch it from the top. So you etch it from the top. So you suppose you deposited 5 nanometer, you'll etch 5 nanometer here, you'll also etch 5 nanometer here. So it's gone from all the horizontal surfaces. The surfaces which are left are these vertical surfaces, so which is why it's called a that's why it's called a spacer or a sidewall spacer, to be more precise. So you're left with this spacer, and this spacer, it helps us to do this next set of implants. So now we again cover it with fluorocyst, we open up the region where you have PFETs, and then you do this higher energy implants. Then you open up this, so this is showing, so this was our shallow implant, and now we do this higher energy implant, so we have this deeper region, right? Similarly, in our so we do the same process both on P and N type, and then what you do is you do a anneal process. And the way this anneal process has been evolving was, it used to be a furnace anneal where you could load up a batch of wafers in a furnace and anneal them together, but it used to take hours of time. And the way things have been evolving here is all these anneals have been moving to shorter and shorter time. So from furnace, people move to RTA, then you move to a spike anneal, which is like in the order of a few seconds. Then people move to a millisecond anneal. Now they want to go to a nanosecond anneal using lasers. And the motivation for that is, again, you want to control the diffusion of your junction. So you want to control how deep or how shallow you diffuse. The more slower you are on time scale, the more shallower your junction is. So that's why the things have been evolving to slower and slower anneals, not slower and slower, higher temperature and shorter in time anneals. So essentially at this point of time, you know, we have formed our transistors. So other things that we needed to do in our semiconductors have already been done. And so actually coming back to your question, that picture was taken at this point of time. So that's why it had those lines, but it also had the spacers around it. So you cannot see the active regions very clearly because of the spacers. But if you remove that, then you can really see that your P lines are wider than your N lines. So at this point, we have essentially formed all our all the things we wanted to form inside our semiconductor. So the next thing is to how to connect these transistors to the outside world. So the, all the interconnects are metal, right? So we need something that connects those interconnects to our semiconductor material. So the material for that is silicide, which is essentially a mixture of metal and your metal and your semiconductor. And the way it's done is you deposit a metal, in this case nickel, and this is deposited everywhere. If you have a small feature, if you don't have too high aspect ratio, you can do a PVD deposition. And then you anneal it. And when you anneal it, this metal interacts with your semiconductor and it forms a silicide. So it only reacts at the places where there was material available for it to react. So it reacted on the top of your gate, it reacted with this polysilicon to form the silicide. At the same time, at these on top of your source and drain, it again reacted with the silicon in your source and drain to form this silicide, but it did not react with the nitride. So it does not react with nitride. So where your spacer was, you are essentially left with unreacted nickel. So this is a very cool process. That's why it's a self-aligned process, hence the name salicide, which stands for self-aligned silicide. So this spacer is a pretty cool thing, right? It helped us to form these source drain junction. It also helps us to these to form our gate and source drain together. And essentially what we do next is simply dip it in a wet etch, which will remove all your unreacted nickel. So the nickel on the spacers you can very easily remove, and what you're left with is your contact on your source and your drain. Important point is that at this point you're pretty much done making your transistor, and you don't want to go higher in temperature beyond this point, higher than 450 C in temperature beyond that time, because of multiple reasons. If you go higher in temperature, you'll diffuse all these implants further. At the same time, this nickel silicide, it has this monosilicide phase, which is stable only up till 450 C. So special caution that is given to the people who do processing beyond this time is whatever happens, don't go higher than 450 in temperature. So this is how it looks like after we have done all these process steps. So you can see that there are five devices here, two of them are PFETs, three of them are NFETs, and then you put a nitride around it. This prevents from anything diffusing in. Some people used to use it as a stressor, but now there's not enough volume of that nitride left, so it's not used as a stressor anymore. Then you fill it up with another oxide, and then you planarize this oxide, and pretty much your front end of the line of process flow is done over here.